Before this month will end, you will have your testimony. I am not speaking to excite you. I am speaking because I know that is what will happen.
Amen.
So I want to trust God that by next Sunday, it will be testimony galore.
Amen.
Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. I began to speak to you on the subject of prayers. And I let you know that prayer, you can only learn prayer by being taught to pray. The disciples of Jesus saw him praying, and they watched him, and when he was gone, one of them said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples." And so, I am teaching us to pray. And that is why it is important that you take your notes. If you don't write notes, you can buy the CDs. You just buy 100 naira and you can play it and play it and play it. I try to answer the big question or questions. Number one, what is prayers? Prayer is communicating with God. So it's a two-way dialogue. I talk to him, I hear him talk to me, I talk to him, I hear him talk to me. God enjoys our communication with him. And if we learn the art of getting into his presence, prayer will not become bothersome because we will enjoy his presence. I spoke to a sister, I think that was yesterday, and she said, "I pray and I enjoy praying." And that is the fact, we enjoy the presence of people that we really love. True or false? I didn't hear you. True or false? The second question that people will ask, and probably you have asked, maybe not verbally, if God is all powerful, if God is all knowing, if God is all present, why do I have to pray? Can God see all the evil that is happening in this world? Why is God watching this evil and seeing evil people doing all this evil and God can't stop them? So if he loves me and wants to provide everything, why should I pray? Now I'm repeating these things because if you don't know them and you don't understand them, you will not pray and you will never enjoy prayers. When God created this earth, he made the earth the domain of man. He said, "Rule and have dominion on this earth." This earth was not designed for spirits to reign and to rule and dominate. So it's illegal for any spirit to operate here on this earth except man invites the spirit either by thoughts, by actions, by words, and by providing our bodies. So the devil, knowing the intention of God, wanted to deceive man, but there was no way a spirit could have deceived man. So he found the body of a snake. So he got into the snake. So the snake began to have a conversation with Eve. But it was actually Satan that was speaking to the snake. And by that reason of Eve obeying the devil and reasoning with the devil. Because today he still uses men and women. It doesn't even matter if you are filled with the Holy Ghost and you're a Christian. He said to Eve, did God say you should not eat out of this tree? He knew that God said that. He also knew that men like reasoning, so he wanted to bring Eve to the realm of reasoning. And today people are still reasoning and disobeying God's word because they are reasoning. Did you get what I just said? They are still disobeying God because they are reasoning. Did God say you shall not eat out of this fruit? And Eve provided the answer and said, God said so. And God even said, the day we shall eat out of that fruit, we will die. And Satan, still speaking to God, but he said, you will not die. There's a secret. If you eat the fruit, you will have the kind of knowledge that God has. Before that moment, the only knowledge man knew was good. Never thought of evil. Only God and the devil knew what evil and good was, but man knew only what good was. He said, look at that tree properly. If you eat it, you will know something that God is hiding from you. You will know good. You will know evil. You will have knowledge like God. And then Eve began to consider it. I don't know why I'm speaking this morning, but I think somebody needs to hear it. And as Eve looked at that tree, now that is the tree she passed every time, she began to see that the tree was good for food. She began to see that the tree was pleasant to the eyes. How come she never saw that before? Then she took and ate, got her husband to eat, and the rest is history, and we're still paying the price today. And that is why you find on the Bible, God will say, don't do this. Because when you walk in this way, you open the edge and you invite Satan. When you worry, Mr. Azebe was saying testimony and said to his son, why won't I worry? You don't have to worry because your worry won't change anything. The prophetic word of God changed it, not your worry. When you worry, it's like opening the doors and say, Satan, invade my life. Now me, invite you, come. Did you hear what I just said? Now how many of you want to open your doors of your life and say, Satan, you are cordially invited? How many of you want to do that? Now how many won't do that? So there are seven. So by our thoughts, you're thinking evil, you're thinking wrong, and you expect good to come. No, because the devil is evil. Whenever you constantly think evil and think wrong, you open the doors for him to come in because you are walking in his domain. You're walking in the area that he rules. And that is the area of evil. Say, Pastor, you don't know what they did to me. It doesn't matter. So long as you think wrong, you open your life for me. Is somebody understanding what I'm saying? So for the devil to work, men will have to invite him by their thoughts, their words, their action, or providing their bodies. Because the devil is a spirit. Otherwise, it will be illegal for him to do anything here. And that is why when we die, we live here, because it will be illegal for us to live here. Because we do not spirits. Already the spirit is with us already, but the body is gone. In the same manner, God will not want to break his rules. He will not want to act illegally. So men can invite him by their thoughts, by their actions, and by their words. When we began to talk about the things of the Spirit from last month, you will find out how you can be constantly filled, constant infilling of the Holy Spirit. It comes by making melody in your heart for the Lord. So by those thoughts, you invite God into your being. I read from the book of Ezekiel 22:30-31. This is important. I spent some time here. Give me Ezekiel 22. Ezekiel 22. I'll read from 30-31. In this city or nation, you find every kind of sin and every kind of atrocities, kidnapping, and all kinds of things were happening. God said, and I sought for a man among them that should make up the edge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found none. I just wanted somebody that would say, God, I know this city, this land has sinned, but don't destroy us. Don't destroy us. Every God moved in the hearts of people to cause them to come to the point where someone will say, don't destroy us. God said, I saw it. I didn't want to destroy them, but their actions was calling for destruction. I looked for a man, but nobody. They were so busy with what they were doing that nobody gave God the attention. If God was seeking for men, he would have stepped up their house, because he would not have imposed himself. He would step up their house, but everybody was not listening to that stirring. They were more involved in what he was doing. And because God did not find any, he had no option than to destroy them. In Psalm 50:15, God said, call upon me in the day of trouble. God is going to deliver us from trouble. He said, call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you. Invite me. Call me. Did he know I was in trouble? Yes. He knows. If he knows that I'm in trouble, why is he not delivering me? Why does he want me to call upon him? Because it would be illegal for him to interrupt. Last Sunday, I also began to tell you about the different kinds of prayers. And I hope I'll be able to be done with it by next Sunday. But there's so much. I spoke to you about a prayer of faith. How many of you remember that last Sunday? And I spoke to you about binding and loosing. And I want to say, repeat one or two things there. It has nothing to do with persons. It has to do with spirits. Praise God. There's a question I think I should answer, because this morning my wife even raised the question. But I was planning to deal with that. I told her about supplication. And I said, supplication is asking God endlessly for strong reasons. question is this: if I don't know the Bible, if I cannot read to find out the reasons and means, if I have not heard any person preaching the words I can use to supplicate, how do I pray? But God made a provision for that. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
God made a provision for that. And I want to deal with that. And by the grace of God, next Sunday, I'll be able to look at the other kinds of prayers. Chapter 6. Are you ready for me now?
Yes,
sir. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. All prayers, the prayers, and all supplication in the Spirit. In the Spirit. Praying all manners of prayers, even though you don't know them in English. You don't know them in your local language, but you can pray them in the Spirit. And watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for the saints. Put your fingers there and go to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. And I'll read from verse 25. But if you hope for that which you see not, then do we with patience wait for it. 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. When he talks about the Spirit there, he's talking about the Spirit of God helpeth our infirmities continually. Helps our weakness. The Spirit of God is continually helping our weakness. And what is that weakness? For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Is somebody listening to me? So what is that weakness? We don't know what we ought to pray. We ought to pray for. We don't know what we should pray as we ought. Now you're sitting down here. Can you anybody here? Answer me, no? Can you even tell me what is happening to your loved ones right now? And those of you who have people overseas, can you tell me exactly what they are doing now? I'm not here. You're not encouraging me. Now, what about if they're in trouble right now? And God said, we must invite him in the times of trouble. So we don't know what to pray. Praise God. And even some cases when we know, we don't even know how we ought to pray for it. And this is important. Needs God's intervention, and the only way God can intervene is that somebody must call him. And we don't know. This morning I am going to teach us how the Spirit will have that witness in our lives. You want to know?
Yes,
for we know not what we should pray as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercessions with us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now listen very carefully, because you have two spirits there
I want to explain to you the two spirits.
Now the first spirit is the Holy Ghost that helps our weaknesses. Why? Because he knows our weaknesses. But the spirit itself is talking about my spirit. Because man is a spirit. He has a soul. He lives in a body. This body is a house. So my spirit makes intercession with groanings that cannot be uttered. Because the Spirit of God will not communicate to my body or my mind. It communicates to my spirit. Are you listening to me? Spirit to spirit. So Ephesians said, praying all kinds of prayer in the spirit. Verse 27. Before I go further. Romans 8:27. And he that searcheth their hearts, and he that searcheth their hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. The Spirit of God contacts our spirit, give us the words to pray. The word heart and spirit can be interchanged. Are you listening to me? And God, who knows the hearts of men, knows what we are saying. Praise God. So if we have to effectively pray as we ought to, then we have to learn to pray in the Spirit. Because when you pray the Spirit, you pray for things that you don't even know, things that you don't even understand. Is that not a mystery? I am praying for Donald Trump. I don't even know that I'm praying for him. I'm praying for the Secretary of State of the U.S. and I don't even know his name. But my spirit is calling out his name. I'm praying. I don't even know that my spirit is calling out his name. Is that not a mystery? That's my weakness. I need to pray for somebody, but I don't know how I ought to pray. And God says, no, I'm not going to leave you like that. But I'm going to help you to pray the way you ought to pray. Nobody's saying hallelujah. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Remember, we're talking about your spirit praying now. Amen. Hallelujah to Jesus. Verses 14 and 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 14 and 15. For if I pray, somebody say pray. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my body prays. Okay. If I pray in an unknown tongue, the Holy Spirit is praying. People are getting me confused now. Is it me that is confused on you now?
Let's look at it again. If I pray in an unknown tongue, the Holy Ghost in me is praying. Who is praying?
My spirit.
Your spirit. Have you ever seen your spirit? Which means your spirit can pray. Praying all prayers in the spirit. In the spirit. Now, when we're talking about unknown tongue, yeah, I'm talking about unknown tongue inspired by the Holy Ghost. Because I realize that some people possess speaking in tongues. And as Angeli, the great man of God, would call it, have you received the real Holy Ghost? Praise God. And that's what's going to be happening in this ministry, because people will be receiving the real Holy Ghost. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth, but, somebody say but. But my understanding is unfruitful. Meaning, my mind does not know what I'm praying. My understanding does not know what I'm praying. I do not even know in my mind and my understanding what I'm praying. But my spirit is praying. I can understand it. But my spirit is praying. What is it then? I pray with the spirit. And I pray with my understanding also. Praise God. I pray with the spirit. Then I'll pray in my normal language that I understand. I'm going to pray the way I don't understand, the things I don't understand. The Holy Ghost is going to give me that to pray about. Then I'm going to pray the one I can feel, I can see, I can touch. I'm going to do both. And if I tell you to pray with your understanding, I can guarantee you the most you can pray will be 30, 40, maybe 1 hour. But with the spirit, you can pray for 10 hours. I can pray with my spirit for 3-4 hours. Praise God. Without speaking one English word. So Paul says, I will sing with the spirit. I will sing with the understanding also. Now listen, I will pray, verse 15, what is it then? I will pray with the spirit, I will pray with the understanding also. Now look at it. I start praying in the spirit. They have taught us you start praying the language, you get into the spirit. No. You start praying in the spirit. And then when you start praying with your understanding, some of the prayers you pray with your understanding are interpretations of what you prayed in the spirit already. And that's how the scripture says, I think it's in the next verse, I don't want to get into that. Pray that you can interpret what you pray. The other day, Pastor Ken was preaching here, I was sitting here for the Wednesday service, and he began to speak in tongues while he was ministering. And I understood in the spirit what he was saying. That when the women come and they are sweeping the ground, I remember I wrote the interpretation and I sent it to him. That as they sweep, they are sweeping away all the problems in their lives. He was saying it in the spirit. So there are a few things that happen when you begin to pray with the spirit, and that is praying in unknown tongue. What is unknown tongue? It's a language that you do not know. The word tongue actually means language. So if it says unknown tongue there, it means unknown language. It's a language you were never taught. It's a language that you never learned. But it's a language, it's not gibberish.
is a language spoken by angels or spoken somewhere else in this world. But the Holy Spirit helps you to begin to pray. So it gives you a prayer language. And when I begin to pray in this language, I don't understand what I'm saying. Why my understanding does not benefit anything. What benefits? My spirit benefits. So when the Bible says be strong in the Lord, it talks about be strong in your spirit and the things of God. You can almost read from the book of Jude 1:20. It says, building up your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Constructing your faith. Charging your faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost. My understanding is unfulfilled. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 2. Are you still with me?
Yes, sir.
Have you lost me?
No, sir.
For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh to men. Okay, if you say no, read it now. One, two, go.
For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God.
Stop there. So when I begin to speak in tongues and pray in unknown tongues, am I talking to you? Who am I speaking to? So when I pray in tongues and speak in the God, I speak in the God, not to man. Now what's happening? For no man understanding him. So don't try to understand me, what I'm saying. Except God gives you the interpretation you never know. Are you listening to me now? For no man understanding him, howbeit, however, in the spirit he speaks mysteries, unknown things, unknown secrets. No man understands him. La brose de yemo. Kanto so tayama rende. Le granda ka onto sumia. No man understands him. However, in the spirit, he is speaking mysteries. Is somebody following me?
Yes, sir.
No wonder Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, he said, I speak in tongues more than all of you. He said, you come to church, you do ba 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 ba. He said, listen, relax. This one I speak in tongues, they do more than all of you put together. I pray in tongues more than you. It's not for decoration to make noise in church. That's what Paul is telling them. Not to say when you come to the emptiness on the game, you come and entertain somebody. I am speaking mysteries. I don't want to digress. A lot of things are coming. In the spirit, I am speaking mysteries. And that's why people, they want to come and steal in your house. On the way, they will turn back. Because in the spirit, you invited the presence of God. the angels will sing. Listeners, God is able to give you interpretation.
I remember my friend, Reverend Dr. Obuki, once said something to me when he was a medical student. They had Viva, oral. They went for the exams, and the exam was postponed. So he went to Ring Road to buy something. And by the time he came back, they said they called them back and conducted the exams. Now, this was the written part of it. That's not the one I want to actually refer to. And of course, when the results came out for that exam, he had 58%, though he did not even write the exams. Now, this was Viva, and he said there were a group of professors, and they asked him a question. He has never heard of anything like that before. He said, inside him, he spoke in tongues. Inside. Then he mentioned a word that he has never heard before. And all the professors looked at themselves. They were amazed. How did you know this? It was the interpretation of what he spoke in this story. If we need to get to the point where we can pray with all supplications, even though we've not gone to school and we don't know scriptures, once the Spirit takes over, it gives God strong reasons why it must be done. And that is why, even if you have not read through your Bible and you get praying in the Spirit, you'll be saying something after praying in the Spirit, you'll be mentioning some words, and later, after 3 or 4 months, you are reading your Bible, you find out that you've been quoting what is in the Bible, though you never read it before. What happened? The Holy Ghost made the supplications with the Word of God, and now you began to interpret it. In the Bible, are you talking for prayers? How? He gave it to your Spirit. Verse 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 4. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edified himself beside the church. What does it mean to edify yourself? Now, some of you have cars here. Maybe at one time or the other. Particularly those of you who drive automatic cars. At one point or the other, your battery went flat. Were you able to start your car? Sometimes you can't even push it to start. What do? You have to take the battery and charge it. Praise God. The word used edified there has the implication of charging. It means when I pray in an unknown tongue, I charge my spirit. I charge my spirit. When you charge a battery, it receives energy. Am I right? When I charge my spirit receives energy. And it's spiritual energy. Glory. It also connotes to build, to design a building. Like an architect will construct. So when I pray in an unknown tongue, I am building my spirit. I am constructing my spirit. So Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6, to pray all kinds of prayers with supplication. Watching with perseverance. Let's go back to Ephesians chapter 6. Did you understand this? Hallelujah to Jesus. Ephesians chapter 6. Verse 18. Praying always with all prayers and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with perseverance and supplication for all the saints. There are a few words I want to deal with here, very, very important in our prayer lives. Say, and watching thereunto with all perseverance. The word watching there means to be alert. And this is important. Touch your neighbor and say, this is important. This one, you can lift up your hands and answer me, because I'm also going to answer. How many of you have prayed? You prayed for quite some time, and when you were done praying, you couldn't even remember most of the things you prayed about. I have. I want to see your hands. I have. Okay, maybe that will encourage you, but that's the truth. I have. Praise God. I have even led prayer points, and people are praying, and before we finish praying, I forgot the prayer points that I gave. Has it happened to any Christian pastors? Has it happened to them? Lift up your hand now. We are not serious. You could not believe that we pastors are there. I have. You know why? You know why? You want to know why?
Yes, sir.
Because we were not watching. To watch means to be alert. You are praying. You are praying in church and waving your hands and your leg and your head. People die. But you are doing this. If I ask you after that, what did you pray for? The fact is that you will not remember. But you took your body and you demonstrated you were not watching. If we don't watch, the devil will distract us. If the prayer does not mean anything to us, it will not mean anything to God. It's that very simple. If it doesn't mean anything to me, if I cannot even remember what I asked him, why must he remember? You pray for 1 hour, but you've traveled all over the world. You have thought of food, you have thought of money that you didn't have. You have thought of what your grandmother did to you in 1985. You have thought of how you will punish people when you get money, the way they dealt with you, you will deal with them too. I'm sorry, God will never take side with you to deal with somebody. Are you listening? Say, vengeance is mine, not yours. You didn't read that in your Bible? He said, vengeance is mine. If you said vengeance is yours, then we can take it. That wrath of man will never fulfill the righteousness of God. No, don't ever think. And I don't get it. Number one. In short, I will build the gate and I will tell them, don't ever open the gate. Number two. Mama Cecilia. I got my children. I send the kind of money. You know, they give me. No. Number two, Mama, when I don't get the money, I know you will help me. When I don't get the money, no, you will not. He will not help you. He will not help you to do evil. Are you understanding? I said, you know, Mama, the children, they suffer. I will even count the money for your presence. And I said, God, see, God knows best, man. Don't give me two. You travel everywhere. He said, what are you there unto? I'm alert. What are you praying about? Be alert. Concentrate on what you're praying. Because if it means anything to you,
just like my master today, I mean anything to you, we will concentrate on it. True or false? Be alert. When Jesus said to his disciples, watch and pray. So be alert. If you are not alert, inside your prayer you will sleep. Inside the prayer you will sleep. You don't know what I'm talking about. If you are not alert, inside the prayer, you say that midnight prayer, you get up at 12. The next thing you see is 6 o'clock. You did not know how 6 o'clock at why you were not watching? The same thing happened to the disciples. Jesus said, pray here, I'm going to pray there. Before he came back, they were already sleeping. He said, listen, wake up, watch and pray. No, you can't pray like this. When you are alert, you will not sleep. I'm alert, that's why I'm not sleeping. Okay, go ahead, I'm going back to pray. If you know you get up and walk and see sleep, what was on your head? Don't die. They say, I'm listening, I'm going to help myself. Just carry on putting your head on top of yourself. So, you can pull with your muscles. Whatever you can do, if it is music, you want to go. Whatever you can do, keep yourself to watch. Every time your mind wanders away, bring it back. It's your mind. If it goes away, bring it back. Nobody can take it away and bring it permanently. If Satan is taking it away, bring it back. I don't send you down and say, now this one I send you, come back. Watch. Because you're praying. You are praying because you know God will do it. And that's the message I want to do. Say, praying with always with all prayers and supplication in the Spirit. And watching day unto with all perseverance. Persevere in your prayers. You must be consistent and continually praying. Continually praying. Old Testament 5:17 said, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. Have sessions of prayers. You can have 50 sessions of prayers in a day. Praise the Lord. Are you listening to me? Some of them can last for 30 seconds, some can last for 1 minute, some can last for 5 minutes. Are you listening to me? Have them, plenty of them in a day. You're walking from your room to your sitting room. La bori, mamangenda ya, adoni, Lord, I thank you for intervening in my life and the life of my family. Thank you for your provisions. I command everything walking against my family right now and cease in the name of Jesus. And you put on your TV, you're watching TV. Praise God. While you're watching, you feel the spirit of prayer on your ankle. Everybody's looking at you. I don't see my chest with the word, but this one is praying. Praise God. Because you are praying always. You are cooking in the kitchen and you're turning the soup. You see, I have children, I cannot pray, you are lying.
Yes.
If you have children, you can sleep, you can wash clothes, you can cook, you can sleep, then you can pray. Who told you that you must give up everything? While you are sleeping, le enkona, la angama. I pray for Marvin, le entro sotaya bakanda. He's the best in his class. Le entro in la ha ha e entro. Ibrabagende ye makataya.
Pray always in the spirit. La ancha equinito. Le enda ando si ekeene. La aleke. Eh, chile, come, hang your back. Mi bramazi kebo sotayaba. Le enda mara antaya. Le enda maza daya. La ande te ando sotayaba. Le bramazi ando sotayaba. By the end of the day, you would have prayed over 4 hours, 5 hours. You are lying. There is time. You are saying there is no time. But then you find time to watch your home videos. There is time. Do you still love me? Instead of sitting down there, carrying the cobwebs and thinking of what you don't have and what you never get, why don't you begin to talk to God that will give you what you don't have? This house needs another actor. Resources for the painting, you brought that out. Because you have a doctor not to charge you so much for this painting. And the table just open. You won't pay this out, just go buy the paint. And somebody saying, but last time when he paid my own, like 3,000 I take, why did I take 5 naira? He didn't know that he did like a master. Why he was busy raising the 3,000, you were busy raising the Holy Ghost. Are you still here with me? So when the scripture says, pray without ceasing, you like what I'm talking about. Because you will never have the time. You will never have the time. To in your busy schedule. But God has given you the time, and you'll be amazed. If you try what I'm telling you, try to get a lot of it. When you do find this body, when you do find this body, at the end of the day, calculate the number of minutes you have prayed. You'll be amazed you would have prayed for over 3, 4, 5 hours. And once you agree that your spirit is getting edified, and now you're saying, get out in Jesus' name, everybody is afraid. You also. No, he's from the spirit. Not the one we did in church. Glory. The one in church is important. But 90% of the time, some people do it for sure. They can pray very well in church. Our prayer meeting. Okay, if you can do that at home, that would be great. Because he that sits in the secret will reward him in the open. Should I still continue? In Luke chapter 18, verse 1, Jesus said a parable that men ought always to pray and not to faint. The word faint there means not to give up. Not to be tired. Don't give up. Say, Pastor, you don't understand. It's almost 7 years I've been praying about this thing. Don't give up. Abraham did for 25 years. He spoke a parable to me. And he talked about the wicked judge. The unjust judge, you can read that from at home, from verse 1. Okay, let's deal with it now since then. And it's taking part 1 to them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not offend. Now when the Bible says men, there is only referring to the male gender. It's talking to we as human beings. Because when we go to heaven, there will be women and men. Amen. It will be
Maybe. Praise God. Praise God. Don't ask me at all. Hallelujah. You know, she's the only one that questions my message. Praise God. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not offend. Give me verse 2. Saying there was in the city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. 3, 4, 5. And there was a widow in that city. She came unto him, saying, avenge me of my adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterwards he said unto him, he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubled me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming. I want you to take the note of the word, of those, that sentence, of lest by her continual coming, she weary me. Right? Okay, give me 6-7. And the Lord said, hear what your unjust judge says, and shall not God avenge his own elect, which cried day and night unto him, though he be alone with them. Praise God. I want to draw your attention to that word, though by her continual coming she worries me. Now, it doesn't mean that you get God tired by coming to him continually. Let me correct that. But Jesus was saying a parable to illustrate what it means for men to always pray. Now, what you must know there, that the woman was continually going, was continually going. And this unjust judge who feared not God or regarded man said, I'm going to do what you want. And God, Jesus was saying, listen to what the unjust judge has said. If someone who is unjust, now listen carefully, if someone who is unjust and does not fear God or regard man, decides that I will do this because this woman is coming always, what about God that loves you and wants to do something for you? So perseverance means to consistently, constantly bring it before God. Hallelujah. When I began to talk about the prayer of intercession, I'll talk more about this. Praise God. Hallelujah to Jesus. Now Luke chapter 11. Luke 11. That was where Jesus actually began to teach it. His disciples started praying. But I'm going to read from verse 5. And he said unto them, which of you shall have a friend, and shall go into him at midnight, and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine in his journey is come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not, the door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed, I cannot rise and give thee. Verse 8. I say unto you, though he would not rise and give him because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needed. And I say unto you, verse 9, ask and it shall be given to you, seek and you shall find, and knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asks receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and he that knocketh is opened unto him. Alright. If a son shall ask bread of any of you, that is a father. What are the fathers in the house? Will you stand up? The fathers in the house. You are a father. You have children. Are you ashamed to be a father? You be papa. You don't born begin. Let me ask you this question. Now, which of you, Jesus is saying, which of us? Including me. Which of us? If your son shall ask bread of any of you, that is a father, will give him a stone. Any father will do that? You are not too sure of yourself, what you do. Will you give them stone when they say they want bread? They are not answering as if they are sure. Will you give them a stone when they ask for bread? Or if he asks a fish, will you for a fish give him a snake?
Or if you shall ask an egg, will you offer him a scorpion?
You
can see. I see what Jesus said. If you then, being evil, if you then who have the ability to do wicked things, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask you? If we as human beings know how to give good gifts, are we all children of God? Oh, I don't like that answer. Are we children of God?
Yes, sir.
Is God our Father?
Yes, sir.
If men can give what is good to their children, then why must not our Father deprive us? But we ask him for good things, and that includes the Holy Ghost. Now, this is a story. Jesus also gave a parable. Your neighbor, close friend. Suddenly his friend comes in the night. He's traveling fast through Benin City. He can't get a vehicle to Ogili. So he decides to branch your house. And then I say, bros, I'm not eating over. I thought I would eat in Benin or at Ore. But our vehicle spoiled. By the time we were passing Ore, it was too late. I want to eat something. And you also do not have any food in the house. Then you go to your neighbor who is your close friend. 12 midnight. My friend, I need some food. Just load me some. I need, I have a guest. 12 midnight. He's sleeping. Honestly. There are times we will not have at our door, not because we didn't want to give them, but we're enjoying our sleep. How can you come and be asking me for food 12 minutes? You will pretend as if you didn't hear. Am I correct? Thank God for our honesty here. My wife and my children are already sleeping. Once these children wake up, and I'm school now tomorrow, I can't sleep later and I beg, I will beg them before I bath them. And this man is knocking. Jesus said, he's not going to get up and open that door because you are friends. He's going to get up and open the door because only too much knocking. Consistent knocking. Are you listening to me? So Jesus illustrates. Prayers without. When you come consistently, there will always be an intervention. Verse 10. And this is important. I want all of us to look at that scripture. And can we read the let's go interactive for a moment. Can we have another microphone? Can any person explain that scripture to me? The pastor, any person. For everyone that answers, or the chief, you want to help us, give him the microphone.
Praise the Lord. For everyone that constantly and continually asks, that will surely receive.
Any other person?
Praise the Lord. That word after there is a continuous word. It means you should go on with what you are doing. So if you are asking, you have to keep on asking and asking till your needs is met.
All right, thank you. You were lifting up your hand? All right. Now, no more chance for me. It's my fingers.
It means for everyone that keeps asking, to keep receiving.
All right. Number two. Number three.
It means this by your color, your size, if you are poor, if you ask, God will give you.
your size,
your height,
tall, your height. That's my Lord and Lord.
Oliri ma we, uwe ebe o, uma ebe o, owa lebi we ni owa no fa we ni we ga no, owi e ga ni nu.
It means you just ask, you just receive, so if you ask, you receive.
It actually means if you ask God continuously, without wavering in your heart, you definitely receive it.
Praise the Lord. But I want to stress on what she said. And what Mrs. Adina said. Despite your color, your height, educated or uneducated, so long as you are in person, he said, everyone that accepts, who is everyone? You mean I can ask and receive?
Yes.
You can ask and receive?
Yes.
Are you in everyone? Everyone. You don't have to be a prayer warrior. As a matter of fact, I didn't know where the warrior was at. Praise God. Amen. Everyone. Don't disqualify yourself. That everyone includes me and you. Includes your little children. Everyone. I think we must teach our little children. I told my little boy, I said, anytime you want to watch television, then you have to pray first. He said, I don't know how to pray. I said, don't worry, you have to pray. My mouth is praying. Don't worry. You know, sometimes we think we're smart before God, isn't it? But God will laugh at us if we laugh. I'll say to my little son, say sorry. I say sorry. My mouth is paining me. Now, which one is longer to say now? The sorry or my mouth is paining me? Even the word mouth, I think, has the same number of letters as sorry. Praise God. No, he thinks by saying that, he has convinced me why he must not say sorry. Praise God. The same way we talk to God and we think we are smart. I would say, God understands. He expects me to understand. Now that he has told me his mouth is paining, he cannot say sorry. But see, I'm smarter than that. And God is smarter than all the way our smartness. Praise God. Everyone. Me, if I ask, I will see. It's everyone that acts. The word access means everyone who is asking will keep on receiving. Praise God. So we must persevere in asking. Stand on your feet, everybody.